Now we can resume our conference with the paper of Professor Alba Lazzaretto. Alba Lazzaretto is Associate Professor in Contemporary History in the Department of Political Science, Law and International Studies at the University of Padua. She works on social and religious history in 18th and 19th century, history of associations, history of feminism, teaching of history, the story of the church in its institutional and administrative aspects. She has published a biography of Giulio Alessio, a university professor and deputy until 1944, then excluded from parliamentary life for his strong antifascism. She works with Professor Gianpietro Berti on a research project on the history of the University of Padua from World War II to 1968. Her paper is about the University of Padua from 1945 to 1950s and seeks to establish an initial pictures of the institutions, teachers and students in a difficult post-war period. Professor Lazzaretto will describe the aspects of the internal organization of the university after the war, focusing on academic problems such as the lacking funds for reconstruction, on the relation with the past fascist period concerning the purge of the fascist teachers and the restatement of the Jewish teachers excluded from Italy University in 1938. Please, Professor Lazzaretto.
Thank you. The University of Padua from 1945 to 1950, short period, but with big problems. The University of Padua was involved in the fascism. There were famous professors who were supporters of nationalism first and fascism, Rocco, Bodrero, Gini, Corrado Gini. However, when the new professors were selected, the university would always focus on the academic requisites of the candidates rather than on their political ideas. So, some lecturers who had gained fame at the national and international level came to Padua, and also there were in the university important professors who were anti-fascist, like Concetto Marchesi, Latinist, for example, who became rector in 1943. In the period of the resistance, 1943-45, professors and students fought together against the Nazi fascism, and the clandestine operations of the resistance had begun in the halls of the rectorate itself. For this reason, Padua was the only university in Italy that earned a gold medal for military valor. And the leader of the resistance movement in the Veneto, Professor Egidio Meneghetti, became the rector of the university in 1945. But after Meneghetti, a man of Partito d'Azione, left wing, the situation in the Ateneum changed. And Padua had two moderate men as rectors near the Christian Democratic Party. In 1947, Ferrabino, who became in 1948 Senator of the Republic. So in 1949 became rector Guido Ferro, the Dean of Engineering Faculty, who governed the university for almost 20 years and resigned only during the student protests in 1968. Situation of the university. After 5 years of war, the university was in a great difficulty following the bombing of its buildings and theft perpetrated by Nazi fascists used all scientific equipment. A big aid came from Marshall Plan, which offered a lot of money to rebuild clinics and institutes. The university comprised the faculties of pharmacy, law, engineering, letters and philosophy, medicine, mathematical, physical, natural science, but political science, as everywhere in Italy, had been suspended, and it was not reopened until 1949. And agricultural science began the first course in 1946, but all the courses began in 1945. Professors, situation. There were only 72 full-tenured professors in 1945-46, all men, of course, and 61 lecturers. Near them, farther than 170 assistant supply teachers, etc., many careers, and also 90 volunteers, assistants, who had no money. So all of them aspired to complete their career in the university, but it was very difficult, like now. Their number increased in subsequent years. So these people, became a source of protest, especially in 1968, they led the students. But there were other problems. After the end of the fascism, the academic senate discussed about the problem of purging the professors and administrative staff or technical staff who were too seriously compromised with the fascism. 20 professors and other staff were suspended from duty. But within 2 years, they were all reinstated. It emerges from discussions held in the Senate that the professors have a propensity to bypass the issue and to reintegrate in the shortest possible time the lecturers who had been suspended. Another serious problem was the reinstatement of Jewish teachers who had been dismissed from the university in 1938 on account of the fascist Russian laws. The Senate records do not reveal any condemnation of what had happened. All the full-tenured professors were reinstated, of course, but those who had a temporary annual position were treated differently. Not all of them were able to return to their teaching jobs. A dramatic case was that of Professor Tullio Terni. Tullio Terni was a celebrity in his field, histology and pathology. And for this reason, his expulsion from the university must have been all the more painful and humiliating for him. After his reinstatement, he was unable to withstand the psychological stress and he killed himself. There had been over 200 Jewish teachers and students removed from the University of Padua in 1938. When the Russian laws were passed, and some of them were assassinated in the Nazi concentration camps. But no one in the Senate drew attention to the fact. Perhaps it was easier to suppress the memory of such an embarrassing situation. The professor in the Senate preferred to discuss about political issues of the day. The academic Senate was divided, and among the professors, a strong right-wing faction, comprising many jurists in particular, fought against all the initiatives that might have benefited in some way the left-wing groups. The atmosphere in Padua was very hot. Students started showing a sentiment of anti-Americanism, especially after learning about the humiliating conditions of the peace treaty for Italy. In July 1946, they gathered en masse in the old courtyard of the Palazzo del Bo, the central administrative building of the university, and in absolute silence set fire, one by one, the Brevetti Alexander, the certificates which the Allied military government had presented to them in recognition of their merits as during the resistance. As stated in the local Gazzetta Veneta newspaper, there was no shouting, no invocation. One could only note the dumb pain in the faces of these young men, while for 3 days and for three nights, the bell in the ancient tower of the university sounded the death knell. Over 11,000 students were enrolled at university in the period 1945-46, 77% men, and 22% of women. But the number would decrease in the following years. A decrease in the number of the students was a widespread phenomenon in Italy. But in general, in Italy, the decrease was 1%. In Padua, the decrease amounting to 10% of the students. Why? During the post-war crisis, of course, families struggled to pay the university fees. But there were another important problem. It was very difficult to pass the exam at the University of Padua. So many students decided to enroll at other universities, especially Bologna, Modena, Ferrara, Milan, Rome, and Trieste, where it was generally understood that it was easier to pass examinations. In 1946, there were 2,000 transfers, 70% of the students enrolled at Padua. And in 1948, 1,000 students left, 10%. On the other hand, a small number of foreign students, mainly from Yugoslavia and other Eastern European countries, asked whether they could enroll at Padua, confirming the role of the University of Padua as an academic point of reference for the entire Northern Adriatic area. These students included Julian Dalmatian exiles, who were experiencing serious difficulties. Having fled from their homeland, they were in need of everything. It is indeed significant that in 1948, the Entre-Ed Universitaire organization sent them powdered milk, sugar, razors, tooth brushes, and woolen scarves. Other big problems among the students. Many students were not in line with yearly course schedules for ricorso in Italian. In 1949, the 35% of students were in this situation. The teachers explained the phenomenon on the basis of the fact that after the war, many careers had been jeopardized. But they also believed, despite the reduction of students, that there were still too many students and that many of whom were not really suitable for university-level studies. The teachers also believed that the university fees should be raised for those who had poor results. These ideas reflected a particular vision of the university. It was the vision of the past rector Meneghetti. So high level of quality in the scientific fields, restricted enrollment quotas, and the regular attendance of classes. Professor Padua would prefer the model of Britain University, more than Italian model, in which the students had very little contacts with their tutors. The students were certainly not very pleased with the very strict approach of the University of Padua, and in 1949 organized an assembly and planned a strike. The lecturers viewed the occurrence with a great disdain and met in the Senate to discuss these events, questioning about the legality of such demonstrations. This is precisely what their colleagues would discuss some 20 years later during the protests of 1968. In this case, the strike in the end was carried out in a symbolic way, but this event was quite symptomatic of the fact that subsequent protests had a long period of incubation. In this period, however, you can observe a sort of mutual respect between the professors and students. The lecturers did make efforts to help, as far as possible, those who studied seriously. And there were strict relationships between the Venetian people and the University of Padua. For example, many people or companies offered scholarships. In 1948, even immigrants from the Veneto living in Brazil offered 2.5 million lire for the new Faculty of Agricultural Science. This example reveals the extent to which the Venetian people respected and cared for their university. Another little example. A noble woman offered a new banner for the university. The old banner was worn. The banner was sacred. As a religious banner in the church, I think about banners of the saints in religious processions. So, like many other gifts, the offer made by this woman may be seen quite trivial, but the generosity reflected a sense of sacredness associated with the university, to which, for many centuries, the Venetian people had offered their respect, esteem, and solidarity. As a conclusion, in this limited series of problems, many issues may be identified, and there are, of course, other problems. These topics and the method of research will be subjects of investigation on the part of the working group for elements of our group are there, of the University of Padua. With some young researchers, we are studying history of the university from 1945 to 1968, from an elite university to a university of the masses. The group decided to investigate the institutional, political, and cultural history of the university and its relationships between the city of Padua and the area from which the students came. A database had been created to collect details relating to the history of the faculties. This is our database. We are trying. The results of our research will be presented at a conference next year, and I hope that some of you will be able to participate in this event. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Lazzaretto, for your invitation and for this part of a more extensive work.